John Calvin says when God answers prayers for non-praying people, there's a thickening of our illusion in our mind that we can make it on our own without God. I'm here to admit tonight, we need God. We are professional beggars. Jesus said, without me, you can't do anything, anything, anything. Hey, say anything, anything. We can't do anything without God's help. I need God tonight, and you need God tonight. And the good news is when you break them down on the highway and call AAA like I had to, sometimes you have to wait an hour or two. The good news is tonight we can call upon the Lord. And God will draw near to us as we draw near to Him. I want you to turn tonight to Ephesians chapter 3. In verse 14, I just want to read a brief portion of Scripture. It could be me, but it's pretty loud up here. Maybe it's as my wife used to say, honey, maybe you don't need to yell. You don't. Praise be to God. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14, there's an incredible text that comes from a prison cell, Paul writing to the believers in Ephesus, and this is what he says, "For this cause I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." Verse 15, "from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God." Now unto him that is able to, as our sister leading songs quoted this verse, I was going to come walk up while she was singing and hand her my message and just say, here, go ahead and preach it. Which would be fine, because she quoted the scripture. "Now unto him that is able to do what? Exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us." Why does God do all this? "Unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end." This is an incredible prayer that comes from Paul's lips. He's writing to the believers in Ephesus, the chief city in Asia Minor. He's writing from prison. He deals with sound doctrine and Christian responsibilities. It's an incredible prayer for believers, comes from his lips as he writes to the believers at ICC. And he says, "For this cause, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." And what he prays for is very practical, but it's very powerful for everybody that's here tonight. And God records the prayer. Why does God record it? Because God wants to do now what God did then. How many of you know when my grandmother used to lay her hands on me when I was in a wheelchair, she'd always quote Hebrews 13 and 8. That's why I never forgot it when I was 10 years old, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, all the way. Jesus Christ really is the what? Same yesterday, today, and forever. Don't ask me why he doesn't always do exactly what I ask him for. I don't understand all that. We see through a glass darkly. There's some things I don't have answers for, but this I do know. God is alive. Alive and well. Jesus rose from the dead. He is coming back. And in the meantime, the church is going forward. Thousands are getting saved all over the world every day. Jesus is delivering and saving and freeing people. He still heals the sick. He still raises dead people, still opens ears, still opens eyes, does things like that. I don't understand it all, but this I do know. Jesus still works in local churches that believe that he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And that faith is in this place tonight. He said, "I bow my knees unto the Father." Now, it's common among Jews to stand in prayer, but Paul bends his knees. It's a sign that he's earnest. He's desperate. He's humble. He's contrite. His attitude is dependent upon the Lord. He says, "I'm praying to the Father." What's that mean? That means he's praying to a God who hears his children, and he's praying to the God who answers his children. So I want to drop four words in your heart tonight. If you want to take your bulletin, if you have it, I just want to leave you with four simple words. And again, if you don't have a pen or a pencil, read reach into your neighbor's purse and take out $20 so you can go to Z1 after service and get some ice cream and borrow a pen and write down four easy words. It's a long week this week. If you've had a tiring day, I just want to give you four words, and we're really going to go to work tomorrow, and looking forward to the leaders' retreat here to cover some new subjects tomorrow. But four simple words, son, and here's my discovery. Because here's what Paul prays for, and here's what God provides for all each of you that are watching by Facebook Live tonight or here in this service. Number one, the scripture says that God provides strength for the inner man. Would you say the word strength? What's the key word here? Strength. I pray that God out of his glorious riches may what? Strengthen you with power by his Spirit in your inner man. What's the first request from Paul that God wants to answer? The first request is for strength and power in the inner man. Now, the word strengthen comes from the Greek word that means to be made strong, to be made tough, and to be able to endure. The word power, dunamai, means force, energy, and might. And where does God strengthen us? In the what? In the inner man. Now, when I stand next to Pastor Eric here, I look at the size of his body, and I think if we arm wrestled, he'd probably win. If we really wrestled, he'd probably win there. If we boxed, he'd probably win there. If we did a kung fu kickbox, he'd probably win there. Why? Because he's bigger and he's stronger. Kudos to Pastor. He's whooped me. He could whoop me. Okay, kudos. You get an extra slice of pizza tomorrow. You'll probably eat three anyway. So kudos to Pastor Eric. He can whoop me in a whoop. But that's okay. My son does the same thing. He walks in the room every now and then after going to the gym and says, Dad, how do I look? And he's good. Do my arms look any bigger, Dad? I say, well, they kind of do. And thank God that you're stronger and getting stronger and can whoop me now because I used to whoop you. And Paul says, hey, wait a minute, thank God for health and thank God for exercise and thank God for your willingness to whoop me. But most of all, God says in this text, be sure that you get strong in your inner man. The inner man. And how does God strengthen us with power in the inner man? He said in verse 16, by his Spirit. The inner man, the redeemed center of our personality, is renewed by the what? The Holy Spirit. In other words, God knows the secret of strength for and power for you and me. What is it? He prays the will of God that you and I be strengthened and empowered from on high in our inner man. How does that happen? Well, we're baptized in the Holy Spirit. We then pray in the Spirit day after day after day after day. We build up ourselves in our inner man. We yield to the Holy Spirit's conviction. We obey the initial promptings of the Holy Spirit. We wait on the Lord for streams of refreshing. Acts 1:8, Ephesians 5:18. The good news, the Bible says that God pours out of his Spirit, out of his glorious riches. You know what that means? That means there's no shortage with God and there's no limit to what God can do in you and me tonight. What's that mean? That means we're limited, but God is not. It means you may be weak, but God is strong. It means you may be weary, but God is full of power. You may be faint, but God will supply all that you need to be strong in the Lord. Now, I'm just going to be honest with you. I don't like spinach. When I was little, my mother would put spinach on the table and say, eat your spinach, you'll be like Popeye the Sailor Man. I didn't like Popeye the Sailor Man. He calls my mother to make me eat spinach. I don't like spinach today. I'm not going to have spinach this week. If Pastor says all we're going to eat for the next 3 days is spinach, fasting is wonderful. I don't like spinach. But spinach is good for you. It will make you stronger. We need the green stuff. I'm into health food. I like green cupcakes. I like green cake. I like green jello. But Paul says, hey, above everything else, be sure you get before the Lord and ask God to strengthen you on the inside. Because who you really are is the inside out, not the outside in. The second thing Paul prays for is this. God provides wisdom to make right choices. Say, what's the key word? Wisdom. Paul said that Christ may what? Dwell in your hearts by faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love. What's that mean? What does it mean for Jesus to dwell in your heart by faith? The word dwell means to be at home with, to settle down in, to rule and reign, to control and guide. That's what the word dwell means. So what is Paul praying for all believers here tonight? That Jesus will dwell or rule and reign and call the shots in the center of our wills. What's that mean? That teaches us that prayer is not to get my will done, it's to get God's will done. How many of you know God does not exist for me, but God created me and saved me to now bring glory and do God's will? How many of you know it's not about you? And it's not about me. It's not my will be done, it's thy will be done. So God provides wisdom and power as we yield to his dwelling or his presence in our inner man to make right choices. What's that mean? It means this. It means in prayer meetings and in your prayer life and your consciousness, awareness of God on a daily basis. Get this, nail this down. It means, because many people serve a useful Jesus. When they want something, when they need something, they serve a useful Jesus. But the last year or two, God's been pulling my heart and making it stronger and stronger and stronger in my spirit that God doesn't want us to serve a useful Jesus. He wants to bring us to a place where we serve a beautiful Jesus. He's just wonderful Jesus. He's just a wonderful Jesus. He's just a one. I can just love him because he's wonderful. He's beautiful. Thank God he answers prayer. Yes, but I don't want to serve a useful Jesus. I want to serve a beautiful Jesus. Here's my discovery. God answers more prayers out of relationship than out of request. Here's my discovery. If we learn to wrestle with God in secret, we won't have to lower ourselves to wrestle with men in public. If we prostrate ourselves before the Lord, we won't be prostrated before the enemy. To the degree I submit my will to God's will, to that degree I'll have the power to say no to sin. To the degree we live transparent before God, verse 17, to that degree we become rooted and grounded. And get this, the word rooted is a picture of a tree that's firm and stable and anchored. The word grounded is a picture of a foundation under a building. It means solid and unmovable. In other words, here's what Paul was praying. He's praying that you and I become, get this, so aware of God's presence within us that we consciously live 24/7 to please his name. That's what it means to pray without ceasing. It doesn't mean you stay awake 24 hours, 7 days a week to pray. No one can do that. God didn't expect us to do that. He didn't create us that way. But it means you become so aware of Jesus living in you. So when somebody cuts you off, when you pull out on Richmond Avenue at a red light, instead of giving them a piece of your mind, you yield to Jesus. And what would Jesus do? I'm in the grocery store, and every now and then I'll daydream in line at the grocery store. Well, not really daydream. I'm looking at the candy, all the candy bars and the, you know. And I'm standing, and people were moving forward, and I didn't see him moving up the line. And this person behind me took their shopping cart and rammed it into the back of my heels. It was not a kumbaya time. Now, they could have just said, excuse me, move forward. Oh, no, they talked to me a different way. There's a lot of forms of communication. And I turned around and thought, oh, how I love Jesus. Because I had to realize, hey, wait a minute. Wait a minute, Jesus lives in me. He can call the shots in the center of our will and help you and I make right. How many of you want to make right choices? I want wisdom to make right choices. My third discovery is this. God provides encouragement in every season of life. Every season. He said that you may be able to, in verse 18, able to what? Comprehend with all the saints what's the breadth, length, depth, and height of the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge. How many of you ever needed an encouraging word? Am I the only one? Okay, just me and the pastor. Okay, hey, there's three of us. You ever wondered if God knew where you were? Ever in a low moment didn't feel or sense the love of Jesus being poured out to you? Well, Paul reminds every believer of this one truth. What is it? That you never have to worry about having adequate spiritual resources to meet the demands of your life. Why? Because you have this guarantee from God. Look at this. It's a guarantee from God. That God's love in Jesus is wide, long, high, and deep. What's that mean? Wide means covering the breadth of your entire experience. Long means continuing the length of your entire life. High means rising to the heights of your greatest joy and celebration. And deep means reaching to the very depths of your despair. So what an encouragement in every season for every person sitting in ICC tonight. Well, you are ICC. You're just sitting on a pew, on a bench. Here's the encouragement. The love of Jesus is wide, long, high, and deep. What's that mean? Wide enough to include you and me. Long enough to reach you wherever God finds you. Johnny Cash, remember Johnny Cash? Before he died, he said, I kept running and running and running from God until I realized God wasn't getting tired. You can't outrun him. High enough to lift you like wings like an eagle, and deep enough to reach the most wretched, vilest sinner on planet Earth and forgive of every sin. Here's what God is saying here through Paul. Whether you're soaring like an eagle or in the depths of despair, Jesus is reaching out to you. And Paul's prayer is that you personally experience the loving embrace of God. And the Greek word means experiential knowledge. It's an assurance that God comes to your heart. About a year ago, my son called me one night, and he's 33 years old. And he was crying on the other end of the phone. And he's never called me crying before. He's 33 years old last year. And he says, Dad, I'm at the hospital with Krista, my wife. And he said, it looks like Krista's going to lose the baby. And he was crying and distraught. And then there was a pause on the phone. And then Robbie said this. He said, Dad, you don't need to drive down here to Virginia. It's really tough right now, but I know we're going to make it because the Lord is with us. Even in the midst of his tears, there's a confidence that comes from his lips. Why? Because inside, he knows something. I hope you know the same thing. Joseph Scriven was 25 years old. He was in love and he was engaged to be married. And the day before his wedding, his fiancée died in a drowning accident. He moved to Canada and he fell in love again with Eliza. And Eliza became ill and died before his second planned wedding. At the same time, Joseph Scriven's mother became ill. And so he sent her a poem with words, just words on a little sheet of paper, that someone else put some lyrics and music to it. And here's the poem that he wrote to his mother, who was dying in her deathbed, and he couldn't get home to see her, and both his fiancés died before he got married. And these are the words he wrote. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. This is what Paul was talking about. How in prayer we can experience the loving embrace of a loving Jesus. And the fourth thing that Paul gives us here, it's a resource. It's God provides, write it down, God provides faith. What's the word? Say it out loud like you mean it. What's the word? Faith for your impossible mountains. Now unto him that is able to do what? Exceeding, abundantly, above all. Let's just say those three words. I said, because faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word. As you speak the word of God does something inside of us. God is able to what? Do what? Say exceeding. Say abundantly. Say above. Let's do it again, all three words. Ready? Exceedingly, abundantly, and above all that we could even what? Ask or think. The word exceedingly means to surpass and go beyond our very request and overcome anything. Abundantly means to overflow with more than enough. Above means to go over and above beyond any request that we could present. And what God is doing here is this, get this, God is provoking us to dare to ask him for the hard things. That's what God is saying here. He's provoking us to believe him, to prove him. This means it's a compliment to God when we ask him to do what only God can do. It's a compliment when my son says, it's a compliment when my daughter says that. It's a compliment that they think that I can actually give them what they're asking for. Do you see that in the text? Paul was writing this, oh, by the way, from prison. Are you kidding me? Why does God write this? Why does God record it in the canon of Scripture for us tonight on a beautiful Friday night on Staten Island? God does it for two reasons. So we can praise God like Paul, even when our circumstances are less than desirable. Paul is praising God while he's in captivity because of a good prayer life. And we can give God the glory for everything good he provides because Paul understands what God wants us to understand. Since our strength, wisdom, encouragement, and faith come from God and not man, all glory must go back to God for everything good that is accomplished in our lives. That's why Paul writes in verse 21, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages. God answers prayer so we can glorify his name. God comes through for you. So what? You can bring glory back to God. Not boast and brag how smart you are. God's not looking for somebody big and boy and beautiful and slick and hip and all that stuff. God's looking for somebody that he can look in the mirror and will see Jesus and the glory will go back to God and we won't touch it and we won't take it. To him be glory at ICC. And when we lift him up and he gets the glory, it's unseen what God will do in this place, in this church, in this city, all over Staten Island, because where God gets attention, God will show up. As long as we just walk softly and we don't touch it. How many of you don't want to touch it? So God wants to strengthen you tonight. God wants to dwell in you and rule in your heart to make right choices. God wants to encourage you in this season, wherever God finds you tonight. And God wants to give you faith for impossible mountains. Here's my thought tonight. You being strong brings glory to God. You being strong brings glory to God. Now, when my wife got sick and I was preaching on Long Island August 21st. Let's just get this out in the open. I was preaching on August 21st, came home Sunday night, took my wife to the doctor. She'd been a little dizzy. Monday morning, she comes out into the doctor's office. I'm in the waiting room, and Laura, there's a big smile on Laura's face. And she says, honey, they told me I have a brain tumor, and it's a big one. And she said, we have to see the neurosurgeon tomorrow. Tomorrow? Well, that's not on my schedule. Yeah, honey, we got plans tomorrow. We got plans tomorrow. And so we saw the doctor on Tuesday, the next day, and she was operated on the following week. took her in on September 1st, they shaved her head, got her prepped. We were excited. We 3 to 7 days in the hospital, home for rehab. I had the plan, we're all gonna take care of her. And 9 days after her surgery, she had a stroke. And I held her hand, we talked, we sang. She said, play me that song again by Damaris Carball, He is Faithful. We played it, we sang it, we kissed each other, we made plans, everything was fine. And then she had a stroke, her body shut down, and 20 days later, she was gone. Where was God when my wife died? I'll tell you where he was. He was the same place when his son died. And my kids said, Dad, you need to take some time off. I listened to them, told them about my January schedule. And Robbie and Bethany said, well, I don't know, Dad. I don't know if you're ready. And I said, well, when do I get your permission? How long will it be before you give me permission that I'll be ready? They said, I don't know, Dad. We just want you to be sure. Are you sure, Dad? You want to start ministry again in January? Yeah, I'm sure. Okay, Dad, I guess you'll have to trust the Lord. Oh, that's a novel idea. Trust the Lord. Trust the Lord. Trust the Lord. Some trust in chariots, and some trust in horses. But you can trust in the Lord. Are you kidding me? And my wife, at the most fearful 22 days of her life, September 1st to September 22nd, when she died, in the most fearful 22 days of her life, she laid in the bed and looked at me and smiled and was happy and was funny and was excited that she was going to go see Jesus, and she didn't even care about cleaning our house anymore and cooking for her husband and ironing my shirts anymore. Can you believe that such a woman do such a thing? The most fearful 22 days, and she never flinched once. And it was no false humility. It was an absolute reason for it. She trusted God from when she was 2 weeks old in church and loved Jesus for 50s. I don't know how old she was. She has many years, and she just loved you. And my son stood next to her and shared the word before she died and said, Mom, you're about to get an upgrade. You're going to go from holding my hand to his hand, and you just be there, and we'll be right behind you in just a little while. And she went home to be with Jesus, and we go on to live with Jesus. And don't ask me all the answers. All I'll tell you is this: God strengthens us by his Spirit in the inner man so we can bring glory back to God and not whine or blame or complain. Yes, we hurt. Yes, we sorrow. Yes, we cry. Yes, we feel all that stuff. But in the midst of it all, there's something that comes from God when you say, Jesus, strengthen me from the inside out. I don't care if you can do biceps. I don't care how big your biceps are. Huh? Thank God. If there's a fight tonight, you go out the door first. I'm right behind you. But just thank God tonight that God put this in the scripture so you and I could find reward. What's the real reward in prayer? God, this is transformational praying here. God changes us as we pray. He gives us faith. He gives us strength. He encourages our heart. He gives us wisdom. You're transformed in the place of wholesome biblical New Testament praying. How many of you want to be changed? How many of you are not perfect yet? How many of you know you're still in process like all the rest of us? How many of you God's still working on? How many of you are willing to say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, go deeper in my heart tonight and change in me what needs to be changed. God, I'm willing for you to dwell and call every shot in the center of my will. When you pray that prayer, he becomes more beautiful than just useful. Would you bow your heads in a word of prayer? Every head is bowed, every eye closed. Strength for your inner man. Wisdom to make right choices. Encouragement in every season. Faith for impossible mountains. The devil could put Paul in prison, but the devil couldn't keep God out of prison and from working greatly in Paul's heart. And the secret is, Jesus be the center. The secret is, when Jesus dwells in your heart, feels right at home, and is calling the shots in the center of your will, that helps you to be rooted and grounded, unshakable. Oh, what's that teach? Oh, that teaches all of us here that praying people are steady people. It's praying people. It's New Testament praying people. Paul said they're the ones who are rooted and grounded, unshakable, unmovable. Why? Because you're connected to Jesus. He's the center. He's the center. He's the centerpiece. Tim Keller said, if God is not the center of your heart, then something else is. Paul David Tripp said, if there's something you think you cannot live without, it's become an idol and a god to you. An idol becomes an idol when without it you cannot receive life joyfully. And God's too good to be blamed for anything. God is too good to keep at arm's length. God is too gracious to you and me tonight. And if you make this song your prayer tonight, I believe God's going to go deeper in your heart and God's going to change us incrementally from glory to glory. He's changing us. Degree by degree, he's changing us. As we what? Become transparent before God, open face, and say, Jesus, be the center of it all. So before we invite you to pray, and before we pray together, if you're here and you know there's something, you know there's something that God wants to change in your life, and tonight you're willing to give God permission, I believe tonight God will gain new ground in your heart. God wants to gain new ground in your heart tonight. If you're here and you know there's something that God is wanting to change, you know what needs to change, and you need the Lord to help you to bring change where change is needed. And tonight you're willing to give God permission and say, God, tonight I'm willing to give you permission to change in me what needs to be changed. If that's you tonight, would you just slip your hand up? You're not slipping it up to me, you're slipping up to the Lord and say, it's a faith sign. God, tonight I'm willing to give you permission to change in me what needs to be changed. God bless each of you. God bless so many of you. God bless you. May you put your hands down. God bless you for your transparency. Let's all stand together. I want to invite you, especially you that raised your hand first, I want you to come and step out and just come and stand across the front here. We're going to pray. We're going to make this our prayer tonight. We're going to give God the opportunity to gain new ground, give us faith, wisdom, encouragement, strength from the inside out, whatever. We're going to invite you to come first, and then we're going to invite the rest of you to come and stand behind these, and we're just going to gather. And we're going to sing this. It's really going to be a prayer. It's put to words. It's a great prayer. It's a biblical prayer. Now the rest of you come. Come on, let's all gather together. Let's stand.